zero. And in fact, I have said we can extend this kind of things to all negative integers. I would like to introduce at the beginning of this talk today the kind of tools which are needed in order to do this kind of job for negative integers without too much work and without too many indices. So in fact, there is a language. This language is used if you want to go to higher generalizations. So let me start with the following definition. Let Z0 be a complex number, and Fn, Gn be two sequences of meromorphic functions on a same neighborhood of Z0. We will write Fn is close to Gn near Z0, so we shall use this notation, Fn is close to Gn near Z0, if there exists a neighborhood of Z0 such that all differences Fn minus Gn are holomorphic on this neighborhood, and converge to zero when n goes to infinity. Uniformly on U. So you see, the definition takes a full blackboard, but the notation takes only three symbols. So that's the reason why, in fact, at some moment when I have very complicated things to introduce, I need more or less to have a way to say things, because I do not want to repeat this kind of thing all the time. Of course, in that case.
So, Z0, this function cannot be defined in Z0.
It is defined up to Z0. It is defined on the neighborhood of Z0.
But in this point.
In this point also. It can be, since they are meromorphic, they might have poles, but the difference should be defined including in Z0. It's not a pointed neighborhood, it is the whole neighborhood, yes. It is. In particular, it means that since the difference Gfn minus Gn is holomorphic, in particular at the Z0, it has Taylor expansion, and therefore the case coefficient. The case coefficient of the Taylor expansion at Z0 of the difference Fn minus Gn, this goes to zero when n goes to infinity. So it is a kind of argument that we have used, but I just wanted to formalize it. And now I will try to do, by using this kind of this kind of language. The same proof as I did yesterday for 1 and 0, I will do it for minus 1. But for minus 1, we will see some kind of structure appearing, and the structure will immediately generalize to all negative integers, and we will understand more or less what the rule of the game is. So in fact, if you remember, we had the translation formula. Which I had already written yesterday. I repeat it again and again because it's, after all, the main tool in this theory. So this translation formula was like this: n to the 1 minus s divided by s minus 1 is equal to zeta of s plus s over 2 factorial zeta of s plus 1 plus s times s plus 1 divided by 3 factorial zeta of s plus 2 plus etc. And a priori you have to go to infinity. It's an equality. Now we would like to know what happens when we are on, and here excuse me, I have to put an index n. Index n meaning that I sum my zeta function only for indices larger than capital N. Here I have meromorphic functions, but here I have an infinite series. Now I would like to know how many terms do I need to keep here in order to have such a relation. And I am looking what happens near minus 1. So near minus 1, I write exactly the same thing. It is n to the 1 minus s divided by s minus 1. I write this zeta s n plus s over 2 factorial zeta of s plus 1 index n plus s times s plus 1 over 3 factorial zeta of s plus 2 index n. The difference with respect to this formula is that I do not put the dot dots here. Here I had an infinite series, whereas here I stop here and I completely neglect all the other terms. Why? Because when I am close to minus 1, this minus 1 plus 2 is equal to 1, and the next term is equal to 2, and we know that as soon as we have a real part larger than 3 half, all the other terms give something which is holomorphic and tends to 0 when n goes to infinity. So in fact, the proof which I have given yesterday tells us that if we are looking at minus 1, we have to keep 3 terms. When we looked only at 0, we had to at 1, we had to keep 1 term, at 0, 2 terms, at minus 1, 3 terms. Of course, if you go further, you will keep more terms. So you have this kind of equality. Now, it's not very nice for me because, in fact, I have this zeta, which I do not know exactly how they behave. But, in fact, I can just try to get the zeta s plus 1 by using the same formula, not for the variable s, but for the variable s plus 1. And then I have n to the minus s divided by s is equivalent to zeta of s plus 1 n plus s plus 1 divided by 2 factorial zeta of s plus 2 n. And for exactly the same reason, because after I have at least an s plus 3, I can neglect the remaining thing. So this is near minus 1. And finally, because I still have this term, I will write down a third formula, which I will apply the same formula, not for s plus 1, but for s plus 2. It gives me n to the minus 1 minus s divided by s plus 1 is close to zeta of s plus 2 index n. And of course, when we see this kind of thing, we see that we have some kind of triangular system. So in fact, let us try to write down this system in matrix form. So I have a column vector. The entries are holomorphic functions, of course. The entries are n to the 1 minus s divided by s minus 1, then n to the minus s divided by s, then n to the minus s minus 1 divided by s plus 1. These are the three first things. And then I have a 3 by 3 matrix, which is the matrix of the coefficients, which I see appearing here. It is a triangular matrix, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0. Here I have s over 2 factorial, s plus 1 over 2 factorial, s times s plus 1 over 3 factorial. And on this side, I have zeta s index n, zeta index zeta s plus 1 n, and here zeta s plus 2 n. And of course, this is not at all an equality. It is just this symbol which I introduced at the beginning, this symbol that says the difference is holomorphic and tends to 0 when n goes to infinity. So it is just the same thing as what I have written here, but expressed in matrix form. And now, let us try to understand what the matrix that we have in the middle is. So I will, of course, here I am only looking at the case of 3 and 3, but you should imagine that we could do the computation with more entries, but it's better understandable if you have only to work with 3 by 3 matrices, but by n by n, because otherwise there are too many indices. And I shall try to write this matrix that we have here in the form F of A, where A is a much simpler matrix. It is the matrix 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, S, S plus 1, 0. And if we were in a larger dimensional case, it would be S, S plus 1, S plus 2 on the just above the diagonal and 0 everywhere else. So it's this nilpotent matrix. And what is the function f? F of t is a function t over 2 factorial plus t square over 3 factorial plus t4 over 4 factorial. So you see, when you take a over 2, you just get exactly these two coefficients. And when you take a square divided by factorial 3, this coefficient will appear here. So in fact, there is a rule that the matrix that we get in this problem has the following shape. And what is this function? Of course, the t to the power 4 has no importance in our case. Not t to the power 4, excuse me, t to the power 3. It has no importance because our matrix is nilpotent of order 2. But if we have bigger matrices, they will be nilpotent of higher order, and it will always be the same function that we will need to keep. So what is this function? This function is just the function e to the power t minus 1 divided by t. And since I have a triangular matrix, of course, what I would like is to inverse this triangular matrix. So what is the inverse of F of A? It is just G of A, where G is the inverse of this function. It is T over e to the power t minus 1. And suddenly we see appearing the Bernoulli numbers, because the function g has an expansion. G of t is nothing else than the sum for n going from 0 to plus infinity, bn t to the power n divided by n factorial, where the bn's are the Bernoulli numbers. And therefore, since I have now the inverse of my matrix, I can inverse this system and write down the new the inverse system. And the inverse system will indeed be zeta s n, zeta s plus 1 n, zeta s plus 2 n, is close near minus 1, of course, to. So I have here B0, which is 1. Then I have to take B1 times S times the times my matrix A, which is B1 times S and S plus 1. And then I have B2 over 2 factorial S times S plus 1, because my A square. So this will be the matrix when you invert it. And here you get n to the 1 minus s divided by s minus 1, n to the minus s divided by s, n to the minus s minus 1 divided by s plus 1. What? B0, absolutely, you are right. Yes. And I am only interested, in fact, in zeta Sn. So from this relation, what do I get? I just keep what happens on the first line of this matrix equality, and I get zeta S index n is close to B0 times n to the power 1 minus s divided by s minus 1 plus B1, the s that you have here and the s that you have here in the denominator cancel, and you have n to the minus s plus B2 times s divided by factorial 2, B2s over 2 factorial, times n to the power minus 1 minus s. And so this is near minus 1. And of course, if I were with exactly the same method, except that you have not to deal with matrices which are 3 by 3, but which are a little bit bigger, if we look at what happens near minus a, where, let us say, a is an integer larger than or equal to 1, near minus a, we would have exactly the same formula. Zeta s n is close to b0 n to the power 1 minus s divided by s minus 1 plus b1 n to the minus s, and we continue like this up to the moment where we arrive at b index let me see, yes, what is the last term? It is b index a plus 1 divided by a plus 1 factorial s up to s plus 1 up to s plus a minus 2 and n to the power minus a minus s. Am I right? Just 1 minute. Yes. We have this. And now In fact, from this equality, what we will let me work out this case, and then I derive it in this case. Let us work always with a case where we have only three terms, and we go to the general case after that. So let us try to see what happens for the expansion of the Riemann zeta function near minus one. So the case coefficient of zeta at minus one is, in fact, you just have to say that the difference of the case coefficient of these two sides goes to zero when n goes to infinity. Inside of zeta sn, we have two terms. In fact, we have zeta of s minus the finite sum. So in fact, this k coefficient will be first what happens for the case coefficient of the finite sum. When I take the case coefficient of the finite sum, I will get sum of n to the power a log n to the power k minus 1 to the power k over k factorial, this sum for 1 to n. Then it is the limit when n goes to infinity is the limit when n goes to infinity of this. So this comes from the finite sum that I have removed from zeta of s here. And then I have to expand all these other terms near the point minus one. But when you expand a power of n, for example, if I expand n to the minus 1 minus s near minus 1, in fact, I will get n to the n to the minus s. I will get n to the minus 1 times a sum of s minus 1 to some power times powers of logarithm. So, in fact, in all the expansions of these powers of n, I only get as coefficients polynomials in n and log n. So in fact, I say my plus some polynomial, which I do not want to make precise, in n and log n without constant term. Plus, and in fact, I have only to care about which of these expansions can give me polynomials with a constant term in the polynomial. So if I look at n to the 1 minus s, when n s is equal to 1, it is n squared. There is an n squared in factor everywhere. So in fact, my polynomial has no constant term. Here it is n to the power 1. It has no constant term. But here, it is different. We have n to the power minus 1 minus s. When I expand it near minus 1, in fact, I will have n power 0. But I will have a sum of minus 1 minus s to the power k times logarithm of n to the power k. As soon as k is bigger than or equal to 1, I am not with a constant term. So the only thing which I have to keep is in this particular expansion the constant term 1. And therefore, I have plus the case coefficient of the function, in fact, B1, excuse me, it is B2, no, B2, S over 2 factorial times 1 at the point minus 1. Since this is a polynomial of degree 1, you see that this case coefficient will in fact be zero except when k is equal to zero and one. And now, for exactly, of course, if this limit exists, it means that the polynomial that we have here is exactly the polynomial that you have to remove from this finite sum in order to regularize it. And therefore, I can forget the precise form of this polynomial and just say I take the regularization of this sum. Regularization of this sum is exactly the limit of this sum plus the polynomial that makes it converge. And finally, I get the following. K's coefficient. Of zeta at minus 1 is the regularized limit minus 1 to the power k divided by k factorial times the regularized limit of the sum n to the power a log n to the power k plus the k's coefficient. What?
What is a over n?
What is what?
A. A in power a in the sum.
Excuse me, it's not a. It is, I am at minus 1, so it is just n to the power 1. It is just n to the power 1. I was thinking I was at minus a. You are absolutely right. Plus the k's coefficient of the expansion of b2 s over 2 factorial at minus 1. And of course, the same proof applies near minus a, and I write it now near minus a, with absolutely no change in the proof, except that if you write it on a paper, you generally have big formulas, and one does not understand that the ideas are, after all, pretty simple. In fact, the k's coefficient of zeta at the point minus a, this time, a is an integer larger than or equal to 1, is minus 1 to the power k divided by k factorial times regularized value, regularized limit of sum n to the power a log n to the power k for n going from 1 to capital N, plus k's coefficient of b index a plus 1 divided by a plus 1 factorial times s plus 1 up to s plus a minus 2 s plus a minus 2 or minus 1. It is minus 1. There was a mistake here because when a is equal to 1, I stop at s. So in fact, it's a minus 1. That's all. That is all. So, this language is still a little bit heavy because we have always to speak of the k's coefficient and so on. So I again introduce some language in order to simplify this kind of thing. And I define a definition the regularized value of the sum n to the power a log n to the power k for n going from 1 to n, capital N, is denoted by gamma index k minus a. Gamma index k because it's a little bit like a Stieltjes constant minus a because it is the Stieltjes constant when I am looking at what happens near the point minus a and not near the point 1. So it is like a Stieltjes constant. If I took, for example, a equal minus 1, this would just be the regularized sum of log n to the power k divided by n. It would just be the usual Stieltjes constant. So in fact, these are called generalized Stieltjes constants because they more or less tell us what happens near a point. And then from this numbers, I build a series. So this is definition one. Definition two we define a power series that we call zeta regularized at minus a by sum for k going from 0 to infinity minus 1 to the power k divided by k factorial gamma k of minus a s plus a to the power k. So we just consider that these numbers multiplied by the standard coefficients minus 1 to the power k over k factorial should be the coefficient of some series that should in some sense be very close to the Riemann zeta function. And now if I reformulate the theorem which I have written in a slightly complicated manner here, it can be reformulated just in the following manner. So this will be the final theorem in the case of the Riemann zeta function. So theorem: this power series converges in some neighborhood of minus a. Its sum extends to a meromorphic function on C, and we have when A is larger than or equal to zero and is an integer, the usual Riemann zeta function is the same thing as the sum of this power series that is obtained by regularization at minus a, plus some other term, which is ba plus 1 divided by a plus 1 factorial times s plus 1 up to s plus a minus 1. So the equality between all case coefficients which I had here just is summarized by this equality. So I had equality of coefficients of this function and this function up to the coefficient of this function. Since this function is a polynomial, this function is meromorphic everywhere. Therefore, this power series will converge in some neighborhood of the point minus a will define a meromorphic function, and there will be an equality of meromorphic function of this form. So in fact, it is this statement that is the statement that compares, let us say, the regularized value with coefficient of the Riemann zeta function. And as I announced at the beginning, there is a small difference between the two, and the small difference comes only from this term. And since this term is a polynomial of which the degree is known, the degree here is exactly a, in fact it means that as soon as we take coefficients after a, we have no difference anymore. So in fact, this is a theorem that summarizes more or less all what I have done up to now. Now I will quit for a moment this subject, and I will introduce the new functions that are called multiple zeta functions. Perhaps before leaving this, let us look at what happens when we try to compute only the value of zeta at minus a from this particular. So I just take compute as an example. What is the value of zeta at minus a? The value of zeta at minus a, I have just to look at what is the constant coefficient here. The constant coefficient is just the coefficient corresponding to k is equal to 0. So in fact, you have to regularize the sum from 1 to n of n to the power a. But when you sum the n to the power a up to capital N, the result is a polynomial in n without constant term. For example, when you sum all the n up to capital N, you get capital N times capital N plus 1 divided by 2. If you sum that up, if you sum the small n square, you get capital N times capital N plus 1, capital 2 times capital N plus 1 divided by 6. So in fact, you always get a polynomial without constant term. So when you remove this polynomial from your sum, in fact, nothing remains, and therefore the regularized value, the value here, is equal to 0. And then we have to look at what happens on this term when we take S equal minus A. When we take S equal minus A, we have here minus A minus 1, up to minus 1. So in fact, we have a minus 1 sign in a minus sign in each factor. It's a minus 1 to the power A. And when I remove these minus signs, I get here 1 times 2 up to a, which is a factorial, and I have an a plus 1 factorial in the denominator. So what remains is b index a plus 1 divided by a plus 1. And indeed, this gives the following fact. Zeta of 0 is indeed b index 1 divided by 1, which is in fact minus a half, which we already knew. Zeta of minus a is equal to 0 if a is even, because in that case a plus 1 is odd and the Bernoulli number is odd. And zeta of let us say minus a is equal to when a is odd, then I have a minus sign. It is minus b a plus 1 divided by a plus 1 if a is odd. And of course, we recover the standard value, which we could get in another way. But in fact, we have in this equality an information not only about the value, we have an information about all the derivatives and how they behave. In fact, it's exactly this that we have in this formula. So now let me skip this and start the second part, let us say, of this series of lectures. Multiple zeta functions. So these multiple zeta functions, it's a very curious story, because in fact they were introduced very early in the history. In fact, already Euler considered them. So. And they appear to have been essentially completely forgotten for centuries. There was, in the 50s or 60s, one or two papers in analytic number theory where they showed up at some moment. And in fact, they started being studied again only at the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s. And I think up to 2000, there were less than 20 papers or so on them. Then from 2000 to 2005, there were hundreds. And from 2005 to 2010, several hundreds, and now several thousand. So in fact, it's a kind of function that in fact, for a long, long time, a little bit like multiple polylogarithms and multiple polylogarithms. In fact, if you look, there is one book, Handbook of Mathematical Functions, a big handbook where all mathematical functions are described, Bessel function, Riccati equations, elliptic sine, etc., with all their properties, differential equations satisfied, etc. You look in it, there is not even a single word polylogarithm anywhere, nowhere. It does not appear. And this handbook was in fact published in the 70s. It just means that at that moment, these functions were considered as not really so important in mathematics. Whereas nowadays, more or less, they appear essentially everywhere. So in fact, of course, there is also in mathematics a little bit like in other domains, some things which are a little bit more fashionable at some moment and less fashionable at some other moment. And presently, polylogarithms, multiple zeta functions are quite fashionable. So let me give you the definition of these functions. In fact, it is a function, instead of having only one variable s, it is a function with finitely many variables, which are complex numbers, s1, etc., sr. And it is a sum, and the sum is indexed by the integers n1, nr, which are in strictly decreasing order, and all positive. n1 larger than n2, larger than nr, larger than 0, and we put n1 to the power minus s1, n2 to the power minus s2, etc., up to nr to the power minus SR. So this is a definition. And of course, the very first thing that we have to do when we study this function is to study first where do these series converge, and second, can this function be extended meromorphically to the whole of C to the power R, like the Riemann zeta function can be. And so it is these first things which I, very first things which I will try to do. So it will be helpful, exactly like in the case of Riemann zeta function, to just write sigma I, the real part of Si, because essentially the fact that this series converges absolutely depends only on sigma I, since the absolute value of ni to the power minus si is the same as ni to the power minus sigma I. And I describe the absolute domain of convergence proposition. The absolute domain of convergence of this multiple series is defined by the inequalities sigma 1 strictly larger than 1, sigma 1 plus sigma 2 strictly larger than 2, up to sigma 1 plus etc. plus sigma r is strictly larger than r. Of course, if you have only one variable, then you have only sigma strictly larger than 1, and you find again the absolute domain of convergence of the Riemann zeta function. So, proof. The proof is by induction. So the first thing to notice is that absolute value of ni minus I is the same as ni to the minus sigma I. And therefore, we have not to care about complex numbers. We have just to look at what happens when we take real numbers and look whether it converges or not. So for fixed n2, etc., nr, when n2 and r are fixed, and of course in decreasing order, we want the series where only n1 varies, and where does n1 vary? N1 should be larger than n2, so n1 should go from n2 plus 1 up to infinity, and this series with the n1 to the power minus s1 should converge. We want the series to be convergent. Because, of course, when we fix n2 and r, all the other terms here are just numbers which are fixed and which do not vary. So we need, for this, we need that sigma 1 should be larger than 1. So this is a necessary condition in order to have this. And now assume that this is the case. Then let us try to bound below and up the sum which I have here. Let us try to bound this sum by using the same trick as the trick in the first lecture by Maxime, the trick I compare my sum with an integral. So the sum for n1 going from n2 plus 1 up to infinity n1 to the power minus s1, minus sigma 1, is bounded above by the integral from n2 to plus infinity of x to the power minus sigma 1 dx. And this integral is in fact the same as n2 to the power 1 minus sigma 1 divided by sigma 1 minus 1. So I have a bound above. Now I need a bound below. Let me see. Let me see. Is it? Yes. So the bound below, again I compare with the integral, but I compare with the integral from n2 plus 1 up to plus infinity of the same thing. This will give me a bound below. But in order to have something slightly simpler, in fact I shall do even worse. I shall replace the n2 plus 1 by 2n2. And when I compute this integral, I get exactly the same result as here, except that I have 2n2 instead of n2. So you see here, you have a certain number of things which are now fixed. The sigma 1 is fixed, the sigma 1 minus 1 is fixed, the 2 to the power 1 minus sigma 1 is fixed, and you have here n2 to the power 1 minus sigma 1, which varies when n2 varies, and the same n2 to the power 1 minus sigma 1, which is here. Therefore, if you decide to sum your multiple series with positive coefficients, because I take only these coefficients, when you try to sum it first by summing over n1 and then over all other variables, in fact the series is convergent if and only if my series, the series sum for n1 larger than n2, etc., larger than nr, n1 to the power minus s1, etc., nr to the power minus sr, is therefore convergent if and only if when I replace my sum over n1 by the n2 to the power 1 minus sigma 1, I will get a convergent series if and only if the series sum this time over n2 up to nr, but I have an additional 1 minus sigma 1, so it's n2 1 minus sigma 1 minus sigma 2 times n3 minus sigma 3 up to nr minus sigma r converges. And now, of course, I have here a series which is of the same kind as the previous one, except that I have one variable less. And I have said I will use induction. Therefore, this series, when does this series converge? In fact, when the coefficient sigma 1 plus sigma 2 minus 1 is larger than 1. And this means that sigma 1 plus sigma 2 should be larger than 2. And then I should have sigma 1 plus sigma 2 plus 3 minus 1 should be larger than 2. And this is exactly sigma 1 plus sigma 2 is larger than 3. And I see that the inequality which I get from the convergence of this series are exactly the r minus 1 inequalities which were missing here in my argument, and therefore I have found exactly the domain of convergence of this series. So now I would like to show you some nice feature about this series. In fact, when you multiply two of them, you can write the product of these two as a sum of new multiple zeta functions. Let me just try to give you an example. So it will be called the Stoeffel product. Let us, for example, just take the usual Riemann zeta function, zeta of S1 times zeta of S2. And let us try to multiply these two things. In fact, what is this? The first is the sum for N1 going from 1 to infinity, N1 to the power minus S1. And the second is the sum for N2 going from 1 to infinity, N2, not sigma 1, it is S1. N2 to the power minus S2. And then, in this sum, which is indexed by all pairs N1, N2, I can divide my pairs into three families. The pairs where N1 is larger than N2, so a sum indexed with N1 larger than N2. Another sum where I take the N1 smaller than N2. And a third sum where I take the N1 equal N2. And of course, in each case, I put N1 to the minus 1, N2 to the minus S2. The first sum is just zeta of S1, S2. The second sum is just zeta of S2, S1. And the first sum, let us call n, the integer which is equal to n1 and n2, I will just have n to the power minus s1 minus s2. So it will just be zeta of s1 plus s2. And in this way, you see that when you take the product of two such things, you can express it as a linear combination of the others. This is some new feature which we could not do with the Riemann zeta function, because even if I start with the Riemann zeta function and I take a product of these two, in fact, I have to go outside of the world of the Riemann zeta function in order to write down this kind of equation. And this in particular was used in the 50s in the case where in fact one wants zeta of S times zeta of S bar, one wants to evaluate the absolute value of zeta S square somewhere in the critical strip, and one used this kind of formula in order to get such an evaluation. So let us try to look what happens if, in fact, I try to do something slightly more complicated, and then we will imagine what happens in the general case. Let us multiply zeta of S1, S2 with zeta of S3. In fact, in this case, of course, I have three indices, N1 and N2. The N1 and N2 are already in the good order. And I have an index N3, which I do not know where it is located with respect to N1 and N2. And therefore, there are various possibilities. Either N3 is strictly larger than N1, or it is equal to N1, or it is strictly between N1 and N2, or it is equal to N2, or it is smaller than N2, and therefore I should have at the end five terms. And you can imagine what the five terms are. They are zeta of S1, S2, S3, plus zeta of S1, S3, S2, plus zeta of S3, S1, S2, plus zeta of S1 plus S3 and S2 plus zeta of S1 and S2 plus S3. So it just means that I am trying to take the sequence S1, S2 and to put below the sequence S3, I do not change the order of S1, S2. S1 is always before S2 in all these formulas. But I try to put S3 everywhere where I can, either between two things or under something. And when I put under something, it means that the exponents will add and I get a formula like this. I will not try to be more formal, but in fact, this is exactly what is called the Stoeffel relation. For the product of two multiple zeta functions. Okay. Now I would like to tell you something about the values of this multiple zeta function at positive integers. When I take this multiple zeta function is convergent, even absolutely, at any point of the following form, A1, etc., AR, where the AIs are positive integers and the first one is at least two. Indeed, we had analyzed what the domain of convergence of our series is. And in fact, indeed, A1 is strictly bigger than 1 because I assume it is larger than or equal to 2. A1 plus A2 will be at least 3 because A1 is at least 2 and A2 is at least 2 also. And therefore, all the inequalities which I had are satisfied and my series is convergent. So the numbers that we get in this manner are called the Euler-Zagier numbers. Or also multiple zeta values. And in fact, a big deal of the recent history deals with trying to analyze what kind of relation exists among these numbers. So clearly, there exists some relation that comes from the Stoeffler relation, because if you take in this Stoeffler relation your numbers to satisfy this kind of inequality. So the S1 is at least 2 is integer, S3 is also at least 2, and S1 is at least 1. Then you see that all the numbers that you have appearing here satisfy the same condition, and you get some relation among these numbers. But in fact, there exists other relation that comes from a different source, and I would like to introduce these other relations. So let us give a definition. A finite sequence definition. A finite sequence A1, etc., AR of positive integers will be called a composition. So this is definition one. Definition two, the composition is said to be admissible if its first entry is at least two. So this is needed in order to have something that converges. Definition three, to any composition, A1, etc., AR, we associate the following binary word. What is a binary word? A binary word is just a word where the alphabet consists of the letters 0 and 1. So in fact, it's just, let us say, a number written in base 2, a sequence of 0 and 1, finite sequence of 0 and 1. And I construct my sequence in the following way. I put A1 minus 1 times a 0, and then I put a 1. And then I put A2 minus 1 times a 0, and I put a 1. And I continue up to AR minus 1 times a 0, and I put a 1. And you see that, in fact, if I call the composition, let me call this composition A underlined, and let me call the binary word W of A, word associated to A, which is this word. In fact, it's an easy proposition that the map that to a composition associates a binary word is a one-to-one map between compositions on the left-hand side, and you do not find all binary words, because the binary word that you get here will never end by a zero. It can be empty. It does not necessarily end by one, because I have not said that my sequence should be non-empty. My sequence is allowed to be the empty sequence, and in that case I will get the empty word. But in fact my word will never end by zero. So in fact, between compositions and words, not ending with zero. Here, in fact, I was a little bit wrong. It is if A1 is equal to 1 or R is equal to 0, I consider the empty composition as an admissible one also the admissible one, or R is equal to 0. This one I consider as admissible. And so A goes to WA, is also one-to-one between admissible compositions and words not ending by one, not ending with zero and not starting with one. Because of course, if you assume that R is equal to zero, you get the empty word. It does not start with one. And if you assume that A1 is at least two, then you have at least one zero here, and it does not start with one. And of course, when you have the word written like this, it is very easy to recover the composition because you just look where are the ones, and you put all the zeros which are before, and you count in each square how many entries you have, and you get again the A1, etc., AR. So in fact, there is a dictionary between compositions and binary words which is given by these rules. And now one has a certain language which is associated to this. So the length of the composition, no, the depth of the composition A, it is the integer R. How do you get the depth of the composition when you look at the binary word? You have to find the number R from the binary word. It is just the number of one that you have in your binary word. It is a number of one in the binary word. There is another thing that one calls the weight of the composition. It is the sum of all entries, A1 plus etc. plus AR. How do you find A1 plus etc. plus AR when you look at your binary word? It is just the length of the binary word. Often this depth is denoted by R, often this weight is denoted by K. And now let me assume that I have a composition A, which is A1, etc., AR, and which corresponds to some binary word, which I write epsilon 1, etc., epsilon K. Where, of course, K is the weight, and the epsilon I's are the 0 and 1 according to this rule. In fact, there is a theorem which was first discovered. It is a very, very simple theorem, but in fact, curiously, it took a huge amount of time before someone noticed it, and the person who noticed it was Maxim Kontsevich. Zeta of A1, etc., AR, is the iterated integral between 0 and 1, omega epsilon 1, etc., omega epsilon k. And here, for the moment, I give you just the formula, and then I have to tell you what these things mean. So omega index 0 means the differential form dt over t. Omega 1 means the differential form dt divided by 1 minus t. And the iterated integral, so let me call f0 of t dt. And omega 1, so it is dt over 1 minus t, and let us write this f1 of t dt, where f1 of t is 1 over 1 minus t. In fact, what this iterated integral is, it just means that you integrate over 1 larger than or equal to t1, larger than or equal to tk, larger than or equal to 0, F index epsilon 1 of T1, F epsilon k of Tk, dt1, etc., dtk. So, we would like to prove this theorem. So, since the notation are a little bit cumbersome, as usual, when I want to prove a theorem, I just rather take one example, very simple example. I work out the example, and if you understand the example, you are able to write down yourself the proof of the general case. So we will just work out an example. I take for composition 2-1. So, excuse me, this is true if A, I need this thing to be defined, so if A is admissible. Then I have this formula. So let us take A equal to 1. I have to write down the corresponding binary word. The corresponding binary word, I use my method here, it is 0, 1, 1. Now, let me try to write down the integral which I have to compute. The integral which I have to compute is integral 1 larger than t1, larger than t2, larger than t3, larger than 0. Dt1 divided by t1, dt2 divided by t2, dt3 divided by t3. 1 minus t2 here, and here 1 minus t3. So, in fact, I will just sum for m1 going from 0 to infinity, and sum for m2 going from 0 to infinity, integral over the same region, 1 larger than t1, larger than t2, larger than t3, larger than 0, of dt1 divided by t1, t2 to the power m1, dt2, and t3 to the power, I should not write this m1 and m2 rather than m2 and m3, it would be perhaps better. So t2 to the power m2, t3 to the power m3, dt3. I just expand the 1 over 1 minus t3 as the sum of t3 to the power m3 for m3 going from 0 to infinity. Then, since in fact all my functions here are positive, I can without care exchange the sum and the integrals and put the sum before, and then I have just to integrate this very simple thing. And I first do the, so when I compute just the integral which I have here, this integral here, just this one, I first integrate with respect to t3. When I integrate with respect to t3, the primitive of t3 to the power m3 is t3 to the power m3 plus 1 divided by m3 plus 1. And I have to evaluate this when t3 is going from 0 to t2. So in fact, what do I get? In fact, I get integral from 1 larger than t1, larger than t2, larger than 0. I keep the dt1 over t1. I keep the t2 to the power m2, but I replace the integral with respect to t3 by its result, which is t3 to the power t2 to the power m3 plus 1 divided by m3 plus 1. And now I have only to integrate with respect to t1 and t2. So I can put t2 to the power m2 plus m3 plus 1 here if I want. And now I compute the integral with respect to t2. When t2 is going from 0 to t1. So I get integral 1 larger than t1 larger than 0. I keep the dt1. And I have here t1 to the power m2 plus m3 plus 2. And because of the t1 in the denominator, I have only 1 here divided by m2 plus m3 plus 1. And I have also my m3 plus 1. And I have to, let me see, no, here it's plus 2. When I integrate. And now I have to integrate this with respect to t1 from 0 to 1. So the primitive will be t1 to the power m2 plus m3 plus 2 divided by m2 plus m3 plus 2. So at the end, I get 1 over m2 plus m3 plus 2 square m3 plus 1. And this for all m2 and m3 going from 0 to infinity. So in fact, I give a new name to this number. This number, I call it n3, n2, let us say. And this number, I call it n1. And I try to look when m2 and m3 vary between 0 and infinity, where do n1 and n2 vary? In fact, my n2 will be larger than or equal to 1, so strictly positive, and the n1 will be strictly larger than n2. And conversely, if I take any pair n1, n2, it corresponds to a pair m2, m3. Therefore, I can rewrite the computation which I have done here in the following way. I can index my sum by the n1, n2. And I have 1 over n1 square n2. But this is just zeta of 2, 1. And therefore, I have proved that zeta of 2, 1 is equal to my integral. So in fact, this procedure which I show you, in fact, works for any composition with exactly the same proof. You have just to work by induction and to write down your things. You understand it better if you work out an example. But it's not a very deep theorem. It's very curious that this theorem got unnoticed for such a long time. And now, from this theorem, in fact, I will derive new relations, which are called the shuffle. Did I say shuffle relation, or did I say shuffle before? Shuffle, yes, okay, I was right. Now I write what are the shuffle relations. For multiple zeta values. This shuffle relation, I first work out an example so that you understand. In fact, I work out this example in the following form. Let us assume that I want to compute zeta of 2 times zeta of 2. So, in fact, I will write my first zeta of 2 as an iterated integral. Iterated integral between 0 and 1, dt over t, dt over 1 minus t. This iterated integral just means that you integrate over variables t1, t2, with t1 larger than t2, larger than 0. You integrate with t1 with respect to this differential form and t2 with respect to the second differential form. And I have again an iterated integral from 0 to 1, dt over t, dt over 1 minus t. Of course, in this integral, I have two variables, t1, t2, which satisfy the relations t1, t2 between 0 and 1, and t1 larger than t2. In this other integral, I have two other variables. Let me call them t3, t4. which satisfies these relations. When I multiply these two integrals, which are, this is a double integral, this is another double integral, when I multiply them, I can consider this as a quadruple integral with four variables, and the four variables are assigned with these inequalities and these inequalities. But I do not know where the T3 and T4 lie with respect to T1 and T2. I know what is the relation between T1 and T2, and I know what is the relation between T3 and T4. And of course, then there are various possibilities for the different orders. Various possibilities are the following. In fact, we will have six possibilities. Either T1 is larger than or equal to T2, larger than or equal to T3, larger than T4, or T1 larger than T3, larger than T2, larger than T4, or T3 larger than T1, larger than T2, larger than T4, or T1 larger than T3, larger, let me see, I have T4, yes, larger than T4, larger than T2, or T3, larger than T4, larger than T1, larger than T2, or finally, T3, T1, T4, and finally, T3, T4, T1. Okay, in fact, I have these six possibilities. So, in fact, my multiple integral, I switch it into the sum of six multiple integrals, of course, always between 0 and 1. I have not to care in this particular case of the case of equality like I had to care when I had integers. Because when you have an integer, in fact, even one single integer gives you some contribution. But when you have integrals, just one point does not give you any contribution. So I do not need to care whether I have strict inequalities or large inequalities. For the integral, it's exactly the same. I don't care about them. And of course, in each case, the differential form corresponding to T1, T2, T3, T4 appear in some particular order. Let me just write the order in the first case. Of order in the first case, it is dt over t, dt over 1 minus t, it is dt over t, and dt over 1 minus t. Whereas, for example, in the second case, it is dt over t, dt over t, dt over 1 minus t, dt over 1 minus t. Nevertheless, I see that, in fact, I get a sum of six integrals which are all of the same type. So it means that we can decide to take the binary word 0,1 and the other binary word 0,1 that correspond exactly to our 2 and 2. And we can, what we call, shuffle them. The shuffle is a SHA. And to shuffle them just means that you try to shuffle like if you have two piles of cards. This is a pile of two cards. This is another pile of two cards. I shuffle them. I put them as a set of four cards. There are various possible orders. Of course, one card which is before the other one in the first step should always remain before. But in fact, I do not predict what is a place of the card of the second pile with respect to the card of the first pile. And therefore, I get the sum of six things. I get 0,1,0,1, which correspond to my first line, plus 0,0,1,1, plus. So at the end, plus, etc. Let me just write down exactly how many times I get. In fact, I will get 0,1,0,1. I get two times 0,1,0,1, and I will get four times 0, 0, 1, 1, if you try to look at these four possibilities. And from this relation, in fact, you get a formula allowing you to compute zeta of 2 times zeta of 2. So what kind of formula do you get? Zeta of 2 times zeta of 2 is equal to. It is the sum of the four integrals. So we have just, you have 2 times this one plus 4 times this one. 2 times the first one. Except that I have to go back from words to composition. You have always to play this game because here you have the words and you have to understand what is the composition corresponding to this word. Composition corresponding to the word 0101 is the composition 22. So you get 2 times zeta of 22. Plus 4 times zeta of, this is 3-1. Let us compare this relation, which is the shuffle, with the other one that we had got before, which was a shuffle relation. The shuffle relation said that when you compute zeta of 2 times zeta of 2, in fact, you get zeta of 2-2 by putting the first 2 before and the second 2 after, or you can take the second 2 before and the first 2 after, so you get 2 times this, plus zeta of 2 plus 2, which is 4. And suddenly you realize that when you use the two things together, shuffle and shuffle, in fact you find relations between these numbers. The relation that we get, for example, from this computation is that the double zeta function evaluated at 3-1, zeta of 3-1, is in fact 1/4 of zeta of 4. For example, you get this relation. So my time is over, so we will continue next time. So, yes?
Certainly.
Okay, perfect. Okay, for today, I am just stopping here because my time is up.